Hello everyone, my name is Henrik Folleus and I'm the game director of Crusader Kings 2. And I'm going to talk a little bit about the latest expansion for Crusader Kings 2, which is called Jade Dragon. And as you might guess from the name, it's about the Orient, and in specific, China. The main feature of Jade Dragon is the ability to interact with China and the Chinese Emperor. Now there is a new screen where you can see what's going on in China, who is the current emperor, what he or she likes or dislikes, the emperor's current policy, and you can see the status of China, what's going on inside China at the moment. The policy. Normally, China is open to trade. It's business as usual. The goods and the magic will flow along the Silk Road. Paper, gunpowder, silk, porcelain, you name it. But sometimes, certain emperors might be isolationist, different policy, and that's when China isn't really that interested in interacting with barbarians in the West. Most rarely of all, China can also be expansionist. That's when you need to look out a little bit, because China might get it into its head to actually invade the West. The situation in China is shown in the upper right. Here you can see what's going on in China at the moment. It can be anything from Great Famine to Golden Age, Civil War, and so on. And all of these things will affect the central mechanic, which is called Grace. Grace represents if you're in the Emperor's good graces or not, and you gain grace by giving various things to the Emperor. It can be anything from a bit of money to an artifact or relic to a eunuch. The emperor is big on eunuchs in his administration. So you use this grace, which is similar to a currency, to ask for various boons. And that can be anything from simple things like, hey, let's have a peace deal. You know, I want to make sure that China doesn't attack me or tries to tributize me or anything like that. To more advanced stuff, like asking for a strategist or a siege specialist or something like that. And the most powerful thing that you can request from the emperor is probably an invasion. The Chinese emperor comes in with the cavalry to trash one of your main rivals. So for example, if you're playing the Byzantine Empire and you have a bit of a problem with the Abbasids, you can ask that the Chinese emperor come in and help you. And if he wins that war, he won't actually take any territory on the map, but he will destroy the top tier title of the targeted realm. So if it's the Abbasids, for example, it would fracture into all the vassal states, which is, of course, very useful. It's not all about what you can do for China. It's also what China can do to you, so to speak. China can also get it into its head to attack West. And it doesn't necessarily have to be the emperor himself. But at the end of a civil war in China, it can be a defeated rebel general fleeing West. It can be a displaced prince of the old dynasty. It can be an Altaic tribe. What you really need to look out for, though, is the full-scale invasion of the West. China might think that there is something actually worth having on the game map. You can preempt that, though, by being a tributary of the emperor or be having a peace treaty with the emperor. But it's a very dangerous time, and the way it works is the emperor himself will not hold these territories. It will be the governor of the governorate to pacify the West. And unlike the Mongol invasions or the Aztec invasions in the Sunset Invasion DLC, there are ways for you to make sure that you are safe. With Jade Dragon, you will also get some interesting cosmetic stuff. You will get a set of Tibetan portraits, Chinese music, and a lot of other nifty improvements as well. First off, there are 7 new casus bellis intended to make it easier for small countries, like if you're playing a count, to expand within reasonable bounds. There should be something you can do, even if it costs you something. For example, if you're playing a Christian, you might have to pay a lot of piety to declare a sort of unjust war, but you can do it if you like. Another feature we've added is the new rally point system. In Crusader Kings 2, it can be a little bit frustrating when you raise all your levies and armies because they pop up everywhere within your realm and then you have to gather them up manually into useful armies. So what we've done is we've added a system where you can designate certain provinces as rally points, and then when you raise your armies, they will automatically wander off to the closest rally points and merge into a big army. As usual, we will also be releasing a very significant patch along with the expansion. The main feature of the patch is perhaps Tibet. We've filled in that with dozens of new provinces, rulers, new cultures, religions, and so on. And I really recommend playing in Tibet because, of course, it harmonizes very well with China in general. We've also made a lot of improvements to the Silk Road mechanic. Trade posts are now rarer, but a lot more interesting, and it's harder to completely shut down the Silk Road because there are many more paths, and some disturbance along a path does not switch the road off completely. It just chokes it a little bit. There's also a very useful free casus belli. It can be a little bit annoying when the Vikings come and abduct your wife or your daughter and make them their concubine. So now you can actually declare a war on them to take her back. That also goes for all other kinds of prisoners. There are a ton of little interface improvements, balance tweaks, bug fixes, and so on, as you would expect from a patch. And our goal is, of course, to make the game be in the best state it's ever been. Prepare to kowtow to the Emperor, because it's dangerous to play with dragons.